Hi, everyone. My name is Claudia Pack, and it is my pleasure to welcome you all to today's Young Professionals Luncheon with Jung-kyu Kim in conversation with Eun Cho. Jung-kyu Kim is director of ACA Investments, a Pan-Asian private firm headquartered in Singapore. He has advice on investments in various sectors, including clean technology, media, IT, and healthcare, and has chaired and spoken at several regional private equity conferences. He's also a trilingual writer who has published works in English, Japanese, and Korean. He started his career at the Tokyo office of McKinsey as a management consultant, and he received a BA in government from Harvard University and an MBA from INSEAD. Jung, can we welcome you to the stage?
Okay, sorry. Thank you very much.
Eun Cho is a portfolio manager with Victory Capital, an asset management firm with $19 billion under management. Mr. Cho covers non-U.S. small to mid-cap companies with a focus on emerging markets and frequently travels to Asia on business. Prior to joining Victory, Mr. Cho worked as an analyst at Franklin Global Advisors, where he specialized in Asia-Pacific small cap companies. Mr. Cho received a BS degree in operations research from Columbia University and sits on the board of KACF. And he's also involved with other non-for-profits, such as Beyond the Boroughs and the Columbia Engineering Development Council. So welcome, Mr. Cho.
Enjoy that.
Well, thank you very much, Claudia, and welcome everyone to the Korea Society's Young Professional Network Brown Bag Series, a talk with Jung-kyu Kim. Welcome, Jung-kyu. Thank you for coming to NYC from all the way from Singapore to speak at the Korea Society. For those who haven't made that trip yet, it's a long ways to get here, about 20 hours plus with a layover in Frankfurt. I'm going to go right into questions since we only have an hour. This will be a friendly interview and an interactive session with Jung-kyu. We hope that we can speak about your background, what motivated you to write the book, and speak on some of the key topics in the books and your thoughts about PE in Asia. First, Jung-kyu, could you speak a little bit about your background, your career path, and what led you to be here today?
Okay. First, thank you very much for coming. It's a great honor to be here. And, thank you, Claudia, and, for hosting me here. My background, I grew up in Korea. Then when I was 15, I came to the U.S., I attended a boarding school, Hotchkiss, and then I got my undergrad at Harvard. Then I went to Japan, Canada, France, eventually ending up in Singapore, which is where I live now. So I'm primarily a finance industry professional working at a private equity company. But I'm also a part-time author, as Claudia just introduced. And what motivated me to write this book is... it's a kind of like a part accident. I was having lunch with a friend of mine who runs a consulting company, and I told her I really love lecturing people, but I don't have any qualification. So what do I do? And she said, oh, why not write a book? And that's sort of like how I got started. I met this gentleman. Young Oh Kim, Dol Kim Young Ok, I'm sure some of you are familiar, who's usually considered like the kind of leading philosopher in Korea. And then I worked together with him to bring about this book, which maybe I can cover a little more later.
Okay. So would you like to speak a little bit about your about the book and what was the impetus for starting this book and some of the key topics?
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
Okay, so the impetus for starting this book, Dr. Kim, who's like the best-selling social science author of all time in Korea, but he's not really well known outside of Korea, then he was commissioned about 3 years ago by a Chinese publisher to write a book for the Chinese audience. So he wrote it. When the publisher saw it, they said there's no way this can, you know, pass the four levels of censorship they have in China. So instead, we decided, okay, so why? And then he asked me to translate this, but the way I saw it, you know, there were some things, you know, that were very China specific, maybe not so relevant to the global audience. So I suggested maybe I can take your core ideas and rewrite in English, and so that's how this came about.
Mm. And in terms of the subject matter, Confucius, his ideals, and also what's in the societies that you were alluding to in China and U.S., what were some of the things that you found challenging writing about in the book, and some of the problems that you see that was the big issues in those places?
Okay, so if you compare China with the U.S., then you would think the challenges faced by these societies would be very different, because one is from the West, one's from the East, one is like developed, one is emerging, and you would think that they're quite different, but then you realize they also share a lot of commonalities. So in terms of social values, especially in the realm of capitalism, what you see is this kind of prevalent culture of greed, what you might call money worship. This becoming increasingly evident in both societies. In government, maybe the way this works is a little bit different in two countries, but actually both countries face the same problem, which is the growing link between money and policymaking. And then in the chapter on education, I also mentioned that, you know, how both countries are now suffering from the same problem, which is this educational arms race, you know, the very wasteful competition for university slots, that's actually straining family finances everywhere, as I'm sure some of you are familiar. So what I found is that as I was writing about China, but then I was writing for the Western audience, so I actually, you know, make parallels, you know, like kind of go back and forth. So you would find this book very unconventional in that sense, because it's a book about Confucianism and China, but it also talks a lot about the U.S. Problems. I hope especially the Westerners in the audience would not find me presumptuous when I say that, you know, maybe Confucianism has something to teach the West about their the most urgent current problems.
Speaking on so what we could learn from Confucianism, what would be some of the things that the things that we could learn from him, and it could be really applicable to our lives right now.
Okay, I'm not going to get into all the details, but let me just point out the kind of overriding difference between the Western approach and the Confucian approach. Whenever there's a social problem, the Western response is primarily institutional. They change the law. They change the whole system of the rewards and punishments, so that, you know, people will behave differently. But the Confucian approach was different. They usually, start with education, and the whole purpose of Confucianism was to create moral leaders, so that their civic virtue would permeate the rest of the society. So Confucians did not worry too much about system building per se, okay, because in the end, it's the people who manage the system. So, you know, I usually call it institution versus culture. Since I'm sure, you know, many of you in maybe involved in Wall Street. Maybe I give you a Wall Street example. You remember the Wall Street Reform and the Consumer Protection Act, also known as the Dodd-Frank, which was passed in the wake of the global financial crisis. This is a monstrous bill that ran on for 2,300 pages. Unfortunately, judging from the recent scandals involving brokerage fraud, the rate rigging and the money laundering, or let me just say this, MF Global, Barclays, and the HSBC, the bill is a toothless tiger, which has conspicuously failed to inject discipline into our finance industry. Just this morning, I was watching the news. The Bank of England is now accused of covering up Forex manipulation by Citibank and some of the players in the market. What should we do? Do we need even more government oversight and the compliance requirements, which will probably do nothing to restore morality to our banking system, but create a windfall for our tax advisors and accountants and lawyers? No. What we need is something else entirely. True leaders who have the moral power to transform our culture. And that would be the Confucian approach.
Hmm. That's an interesting point. So in your book, you do talk about that it's really up to the people, and the Confucius thoughts are that innately people are good and the good will prevail in some ways. But what's going on in the U.S. regulations, it does seem to err on the side that more regulations needed, more systematic approaches needed to do this. But how can we evolve from the regulations and systematic ways to fixing things to giving more power to the people who want to do better things or do good things in this system?
Right. So it's all about values. What society values? Is it money and status and power that the society values? And if you live in Manhattan, you feel that every day. Okay. Or is it things like kindness and compassion, public service, honest at work? Are those things that we value as a society? And I think what happened in the U.S. Is that there used to be this set of Protestant ethics, which kind of balanced the animal spirit of capitalism. And on the one hand, you have this very capitalist value about that what you make is what you keep. But on the other hand, you had this all Christian values about loving and sharing, maybe until the 60s. Okay, then what seemed to happen is that the society has grown more secular. Now all this what's left is now this materialist value about like there was Ayn Rand's book called The Virtue of Selfishness, and then there was this great line from the movie Wall Street, greed is good, now this whole theory of rational self-interest, which is saying that it's rational to be selfish. If you are selfless, then you're being irrational. So what I'm saying is that this change needs to happen with maybe, not changing laws any further, but maybe, we need to change our philosophy, what we value as a society.
Hmm. Okay. So you're in finance. I think people in the world are somewhat, there's been a little bit of animosity towards people in finance, but you're writing a book about Confucianism and the good in people, and that approach should be better than the systematic approach. How do you deal with being in finance and the subject matter you wrote in the book?
Yes, that's a very good question. First, on the personal level, I think what I'm doing is, what people call the kind of barbell portfolio approach. This is actually from the book Anti-Fragile by Nassim Nicholas Taleb. Some of you might have read that book. Basically, what it says is that, if you have money, let's say $100, then you put $90 into something like really secure, like government bond, so that, whatever happens, your maximum loss is only 10%. Okay. But then you put that remaining 10%, it is into something really risky, like venture financing, which, you know, has a low probability of success. But if it succeeds, then, you know, it's going to, you know, it can be tenfold or 20-fold. You know, the payoff can be unlimited, right? So essentially, you build a portfolio where the maximum loss is 10% and the upside is pretty much unlimited. And I think for me, you know, what I'm doing in finance is this 90% part. Which is actually paying my rent at the moment. But then, you know, I'm also like a part-time author where, you know, I have this writing activity, which, you know, I'm hoping, you know, this could also make some impact. And I mean, okay, I'm this on a like very pragmatic level. But if I ever do a book again, I might actually write about Confucian management.
Confucian management.
Okay. Confucian management. And which is quite different from like the Western management, because Western companies, large Western companies, they are like an autocracy, you know, run by a handful of people for the benefit of a handful of people. And the employees are, you know, just seen as money-making tools. And that when you don't need a tool, what do? You throw away. And I think that the Eastern approach, you can call it Confucian, you can call it Japanese management, you can call it whatever you want. It's more about you know, how to make the employees happy, how to get them more involved, how to recognize the fact that, you know, that the company exists for the benefit of employees. So what I'm saying is, you know, what I'm doing in work and this intellectual pursuit have a way of converging.
I see. Okay. The Winter Olympics in Sochi just started. Any thoughts in regarding what's going on in Russia and the politics there?
Okay, but by the way, I think the opening ceremony is like right now.
Yeah.
So thank you so much for coming here instead. For those of you who missed it, 7:30 NBC, they're going to play the replay. Okay. Now, with Russia, I think what Russia shows is that there was this very famous dialogue in Confucius where, you know, a disciple asked Confucius, you know, what are the priorities of government? And Confucius says, well, the government needs to provide food and a strong army and also the public trust. Then the disciple asked him, well, if you had to sacrifice one, which one would you sacrifice? And he said, oh, throw away the army. Okay. Then if it really cannot be helped, out of the remaining two, which would you sacrifice? And he said, well, give up on the food, because, you know, from of old, people die one way or the other. But if there's no public trust, the society cannot stand. I think what Putin has done is he's given the country a strong army and a strong economy. But that bond of trust between the government and people are just broken beyond repair. And so, you know, you've seen about 2 years ago, there was all this Muscovites on the street in the largest mass protest, you know, when, you know, Putin came back to power. Then, you know, you see all these smart and young people leaving the country. So, you know, that does not really bode well for the future of the country, unfortunately.
Okay. One last question before we open up to the audience. There's been some tension between Japan versus China, also versus Korea. Any thoughts on that?
As a matter of disclosure, I lived in Japan for 7 years. I speak fluent Japanese. My first job was as a business analyst at McKinsey Tokyo. My wife is Japanese. So I'm very torn, you know, by what's happening right now. Having said that, my opinion on this matter is very clear. Japan must come to terms with its past. If you look at what's happening with China, the Senkaku Islands, you know, the Diaoyu Islands, these are pieces of rock on the Pacific Ocean, right? This was annexed by Japan in 1895. Which is the very year that the first Sino-Japan war broke out, and Japan basically took the port of Weihai and the Taiwan, and you know, like so, it's and then, you know, when you look at the Dokdo, you know, the Takeshima, the islands. Then, you know, when the Shimane Prefecture annexed it was 1905, the same year as the first Korea-Japan Protectorate Treaty, you know, when basically Japan took the diplomatic sovereignty from Korea and made it its protectorate. So what I'm saying is that these timings, okay, it's not a coincidence. They make it abundantly clear that Japan took these islands as part of the wider imperial strategy back then. And the problem is that, you know, when the San Francisco Treaty was signed after the war in 1952 or 54, the document just failed to mention these islands as a part of the territories to be returned by Japan, allowing Japan to claim that they still have the legal rights to these islands. I think the bottom line is, well, the Japanese themselves have to decide what they want to do. Okay, I mean, it's up to them. But they need to recognize this fact that, you know, the more they distort their past, the poorer their future will be. Why? Because their future is in Asia, not outside of it. China is their largest trading partner. The US is second. Korea is their third largest trading partner. So, I mean, again, I mean, it's like it's up to them to decide. But, you know, I really do hope that the Prime Minister Abe, you know, come back to his senses and, you know, I mean, make this, I mean, you know, make conciliatory gestures.
Jung-kyu, I forgot that you have a presentation. Did you want to go through the presentation before we open up?
Yeah, maybe it's a good segue to the finance. Actually, what I do as a daytime job. Okay, and I understand this is a young professional series. Okay, so I work at this company called ACA Investments. So if I explain about this company, it will explain a lot about what I do because I'm a founding director. Okay, so the company was founded in 2008, actually as a spin-off from another private equity company. The company is owned about 60% by the employees, 40% by Sumitomo Corporation, which is a Japanese trading company. Until last year, we were headquartered in Tokyo. Now we are headquartered in Singapore, and I'll explain why. Next. How do I go next? Oh, okay. So this is our track record to date. For those of you who know finance, okay, so we divide our funds into two categories, the ones that are already finished and the ones that are still ongoing. So you can think of us like finished investments and ongoing investments. And if you are like a seasoned fund manager, then you would ignore the second row. The reason is because in this remaining investment, unlisted shares, people can just put whatever value they want. Okay, so you just look at what's been realized, what's been actually distributed, and so what you will see is that we have managed, we have invested about $700 million over the last 5 years, and that we have distributed about close to $1 billion, and we have some remaining value. So for the net IRR, the annualized return. Of almost 30%, and in terms of multiple, it's actually pretty normal. It's 1.6 times. So out of the private equity fund managers in Asia, okay, active in Asia, that we actually picked a sample. I actually picked a sample of 66 fund managers with a private equity fund of $100 million and above, and with the vintage between 2005 and 2010, just to make it comparable. Out of the 66 funds, you know, we would have ranked number 7 or number 6. So that makes us one of the top performing fund managers in Asia. We have expanded outside of Japan. So we initially got started in Tokyo. Now we have our headquarters in Singapore, and we also have a partner in Mumbai. So we actually call this Asian growth triangle. Although, you know, because the earth is round, it's not exactly a triangle. And we have joint ventures in Thailand, Malaysia, Vietnam, and China. So, you know, now we have pretty much the pan-Asian coverage. Okay. Why focus on these markets? Because of growth. So this is actually showing from mid-2009 to mid-2013, what was the stock index doing in Indonesia, India, Malaysia, Philippines, Thailand, Singapore. Now, the market in the US has almost doubled during this period as well. But some of the growth that you see is just, wow. It's like Indonesia, you know, which basically gone up like quadruple, and then Thailand triple. Well, okay, Thailand may have come back down a little bit right now because of the political situation. But, you know, I think the long-term trend is clear that these are fast-growing markets. So what's our rationale for having this Asia network? By the way, ACA stands for Asian Capital Alliance. We connect markets through capital investment. This is what we call growth and regrowth. Growth meaning that we invest in growth companies of emerging markets of Asia. Then we accelerate that growth by bringing in some strategic investor, let's say from Japan or maybe Korea. Okay, or we can do it the other way around. We can invest in a Japanese or Korean company. Okay, maybe they have a good technology or management know-how, or brand, a business model, whatnot. But the stock market valuation is distressed because the market's mature and it's not growing so fast anymore. Then we invest in those companies. Then find them a partner in one of the emerging markets of Asia. So then now they have the growth story again. So the synergy can work both ways, but what we believe in is connecting these kind of mature markets and the emerging markets through capital. I'll just skip this, okay? Oops. If I can skip this, okay. Then I just wanted to mention briefly that we also do pipes. Or, we are a private equity company, but we also invest in publicly listed companies. Not getting into the details, but, some people get confused because you are private equity. Why are you investing in publicly listed firms? To them, I tell them, look, the key difference between a hedge fund and the private equity, it's not about, whether the investee is listed or not. The key difference is liquidity. Hedge funds, because they have this redemption every 3 months, they have to invest in a relatively liquid asset, okay? Because the investor can, call their money at a very short notice. Whereas private equity, we can hold any investment up to like 7 years. So, we can take a much longer term view. You can be involved in a much more strategic level. What I'm saying is that we apply private equity approach to small cap listed companies in Asia. And why it makes sense is in emerging market, there are several benefits to working with these small listed companies. One is that the capital market has a very weak disclosure rules. And contracts may not mean much in these markets. Okay, So in countries with a less developed rule of law and the relatively weak capital markets, also the market may not be so deep, then this is like a kind of market where it's actually very ripe for private equity investors to come in and work with small listed companies. Just to show you, it's 22,000 listed companies in the region. So unless your risk appetite is very high. I don't even know. Why people would want to focus on unlisted companies in this region, unless they are tied to some very big companies. And this is just to illustrate the benefit of our approach. How we approach such high annualized return is because our average holding period of an investment is less than 2 years, which is very short for a private equity company. What many private equity companies do is they hold an investment for like 4 to 5 years. But then, to achieve the same kind of return as we do, then they need to like quadruple or quintuple the value of their investment, which is very difficult. Whereas what we are trying to do is that maybe get 1.7 or 1.8 times our investment within 2 years. Then that would give us like 35% IRR, and much less risky and much more realistic. Yeah, I mean, just summarize that, you know, I mean, we have a good track record, and that we try to add value, especially cross-border. And then, you know, we have a rather unique strategy of among private equity firms of, you know, focusing on small listed companies. Thank you very much.
Okay, so let's open up to questions. So when you're asked your questions, can you state your name and the company you represent? Back there first.
I guess I'll stand up. My name is Michael Turney. I'm with MTS Health Partners. I guess my question, you talked broadly about private equity within Asia as a whole. Can you talk a little bit more specifically about, I guess, your experience within the private equity landscape in Korea?
Oh, okay. I think Korea is a frustrating market for private equity managers. And the reason is, I think the two reasons. One is that, you know, Korea has some very large companies, you know, like the 30 chaebols, top chaebols. But then, you know, you don't have much in between. Then you have all these small and medium-sized enterprise. And so, you know, you feel like, wow, you know, this whole middle is missing. Unlike, let's say, Japan or Germany, where, you know, you have a very strong layer of companies in the middle. And the reason for that is because the chaebols have been squeezing their suppliers too hard, not allowing them to grow. So if you look at like Japan, you know, Toyota allowed Denso to grow as like the supplier, and you know, Denso is like now, you know, very big. And so you know, anyway, setting that issue aside, so yeah, what are the opportunities available? Basically the auction deals, usually from the restructuring of a chaebol, you know, when they want to sell off one of their business line or subsidiary, then you know, it becomes an auction deal. Then inevitably, what happens is that, you know, there's the winner's curse, right? You know, you overpay. So you know, MBK Partners, you know, they are well accused of you know, overpaying for their assets, and then foreigners complain that they cannot compete in this market. Now that's the frustrating part. Okay, but then also it is true that Korean companies over the long term have been doing quite well. I mean, despite all their like idiosyncratic approaches to management, or you know, just you know, like defying all the rules, somehow they've been thriving. And what's behind it? And the best analysis I've seen is in this book, Breakout Nations, where what's his name? The Indian Rajesh Sharma or something, the head of a global markets at Morgan Stanley. Anyway, what he says is that what Korea has is a publicly listed family company. I mean, there's been this whole debate about is a public company better or is a family-owned company better? I mean, this has been like a long-term debate in business schools. The answer is that, you know, maybe family office and family-owned business is stronger as long as the family, you know, doesn't fight with each other, okay? And but, you know, usually the family-owned company, you know, bring the, like, the long-term vision and the strategic drive to expand the business, right? Now, publicly listed company, what's the benefit? You know, there are like rules for disclosure, corporate governance, so that the company basically has to comply with like higher standards. Now, in Korea, what you see is that a lot of these are pretty much like family-owned companies, but they're listed on stock market, so that it kind of combines best of both worlds. So, you know, am I kind of bullish on the long term in about Korea? Yeah, I mean, I am.
Okay, next question here.
Yes, I'm James Lee. I'm with the Boutique Investment Bank here in New York. And my question to you is, in what kinds of sectors, I mean, does your fund invest in? I mean, do you focus on certain industries, or is it just across the board industry, you know, industry agnostic?
Okay, we are sector agnostic, but there are some sectors that we don't do, such as commodities or property. And the reason for that is because, you know, those markets, you know, basically it's about market movement and timing, right? And those are risks that are beyond our control. We want to focus on sectors which we understand and that we are confident that regardless of the market movement, that this sector is going to grow. So take like consumer retail or healthcare in Indonesia, for example. I mean, you know that, you know, whatever the global market does, that these sectors will grow, you know, at twice, you know, like at double digit growth for the foreseeable future, right? And so we want to focus on those.
Next question.
What are your thoughts in terms of the long-term impacts of the Fed tapering and how it's impacting your investments overseas, emerging markets? Are you guys seeing any reverberations?
You know, maybe you can answer this question better.
The view of the emerging markets is becoming a lot riskier. And what happened with the past 6 months to now is that a lot of the hot money has left the markets. But when you look at it in terms of valuations, the valuations of emerging markets have become a lot more compelling. Mm-hmm. You also saw that because of just put your money in the U.S. stock market, it will go up. The valuations have actually gone really expensive. So during some of the corporate earnings, there were some companies who actually missed. So our company view is that the valuations and all the fundamentals of emerging market will become a lot more attractive, and it could be an interesting opportunity going forward. But in terms of the specific risk, currency is always an issue. Indonesia, I know Indonesia is one of your favorite markets. The currency depreciated 20%. So if you're an investor, took your U.S. dollars and put it into an Indonesian market, and the market was flat, you're already down 20% because you're invested in an Indonesian market. So those are some of the concerns that investors have to be able to deal with in investing in emerging markets.
Yeah, no, I totally agree that when you look at these governments, let's say the government of Indonesia versus let's say Turkey or Argentina or some of these countries which are being targeted by the investors right now, you see that the macroeconomic management of the Indonesian government has been actually quite conservative. You know, low interest rate, low inflation, big foreign currency reserve, and so you know, I don't see much impact on the emerging markets that I'm focusing on, from this kind of global, the easing of the tapering off of QE. Yeah.
How about in terms of the relations of regulatory issues? I know that between the SEC and the Chinese SEC, there's major issues in terms of audits and company financial reporting. I know that a lot of the ADRs that are trading in the U.S. and New York stock business got nailed off those because, quite frankly, people are now questioning their financials. What do you guys look at in terms of those financials? Do you kind of take it for what it is, or is there underlying issues? I know you were talking about regulatory issues and kind of emerging areas that you see.
I don't know. Do you trust Chinese companies' accounts?
our investors pays us to go to those countries and ask those questions directly to the CFOs and so on. It's interesting. You would assume that a Chinese company being listed in the U.S. would be safe, but there have been a lot of these reports that are coming out from these smaller shops, Muddy Waters being one of them, just highlighting some of the irregularities in these accountings. I think if you're looking to invest in these markets, it's really prudent for you to do the work, right? You can't just assume what the company is telling you. That's what's actually happening. Maybe you can one of the methods that we use in terms of looking at accounting is who are the auditors, right? Are the auditors the top six global firms, or are they the local firms? And if there's a local firm auditing their books, that might be a little bit of a red flag. So there are a lot of ways to kind of weed out all the issues that are going on, but It's an issue. I think the Chinese government are looking at it and are trying to somewhat stem out all the bad companies. But that's the risk of investing in emerging markets.
Yeah, I mean, for us, because we invest in usually small companies, many unlisted companies actually in China, then what we do is we send a team on the ground. Look through all their books to make sure we clean things up, make them ready for IPO, because some of these companies, actually most of these companies, haven't been paying taxes, and you got to clean that up before the company can go IPO. And I think the SEC rule that you're mentioning, I think they concern more of the large companies which are already listed on the stock market, but for the companies we are focusing on, they're not so relevant.
Okay, question in the back.
My question relates to your beginning discussion about Confucian values and the point you made about how people actually end up being more important than kind of a body of rules standing by itself. And I think one could make the argument easily that in America itself, that there are companies that are known for very different kinds of cultures, and maybe some of the best performing companies actually tend to attract the best people. And you know, what came first, God only knows. You also made the distinction between perhaps management approaches in the West versus in Asian companies. And I think there was an article yesterday or something about how Toyota is again the, you know, number one automaker, and its profit will exceed the top three US automakers combined, which is not a bad outcome. But there's also kind of a popular characterization that quarterly earnings puts a great deal of pressure upon American management and boards with regard to the flexibility they have in what they can do. And I'm curious as to what your feeling is that given the dynamics of the market as it exists today in terms of investors, in terms of quarterly earnings releases and so on, do you feel that there actually is significant opportunity for people who are trained and inculcated with a Confucian value approach to actually rise through their organizations and lead them in the direction they'd like them to?
Yeah, and for those companies to actually succeed in this competitive global market, right? And I definitely believe so. You know, in China right now, there is one entrepreneur who's like a rock star, and his name is Kazuo Inamori. He's the founder of Kyocera, and also KDDI, and he turned around Japan Airlines recently. So his books are stacked like right next to those of Steve Jobs, you know, if you go to any like bookstore in China. And then you look at what's his message? You know, his message very simple. You know, like employees are like the most important. You know, you have to involve them, and you know, he calls it like a unifying approach to management. And then you know, he tell people that, you know, he'll tell the management, you have to be honest, never lie. You have to be passionate about the product that you create. You have to create product that pushes the envelope every time you create something. I mean, things like that. I mean, these are such like banal messages, and why did they apply so deeply to the Chinese is because right now in China, I mean, when you hear made in China, what do you think? I would think three adjectives, okay? Cheap, fake, inferior. Okay, I mean that's like that's like the most common adjective, you know, that we usually associate with made in China today. And I think the Chinese themselves are sick of this. Okay, and they want to make a transition to something more value added. They want to, you know, create a company that's actually this differentiated enough in the marketplace that they no longer have to compete purely on the basis of cost. But how can a company create a great product or deliver exceptional services with disgruntled employees? And this is where Confucianism comes in. This is where that Inamori's you know, unifying approach to management comes in. That where, you know, I think as far as the Chinese companies are concerned, I think they have a huge opportunity to adopt, for the sake of simplicity, right? More Japanese style management than the American style management, and I think it's going to be good for them as the economy needs to make this transition from cheap manufacturing to more value added services.
Okay, question back there.
Yes, hi, Dr. Kim. My name is Paul Marino. I'm with the Policy Group here in Manhattan, Young Professionals in Foreign Policy. I look forward to reading your book. I appreciate a lot what you said about Confucianism. When I was in Chinatown just a couple week ago for the parade celebrating the new year, they have a beautiful statue to Confucius, and it talks about his common principles and a very uplifted view of mankind. And I say that in my country's history, in the preamble, the general welfare, and a couple of key people in banking like Alexander Hamilton, unfortunately, it's not at present, but maybe in the future. As I look to Asia, I'm interested in high-tech goods, capital development, atomic power, and the potential for where the futures are to develop this further, also in the Arctic, and perhaps to bring the United States along in that kind of orientation for longer-term investments. Mm-hmm. I share your view that the United States shies away from anything long-term, and that is a big problem. My one idea about this is that it can be solved if culturally we orient more to a long-term idea something inspiring like a space program, or something really challenging like Arctic or Pacific development that really pushes the frontiers of what our technology can do. So I'd appreciate any thoughts you have on some of that.
Okay. As for this short-term outlook in diplomacy, the problem with the U.S. Democracy is that these political appointees, they change so regularly that it's almost impossible to build any long-term relationship, you know, between, like, let's say, a Korea diplomat in the State Department and someone from, like, Gaimusho in Japan or, you know, like, whatever. I mean, it's very difficult to pull off. And I think the good thing about the Asian approach, which I would say, you know, this is common to Singapore and China and to some extent to Japan as well, is, you know, it's like a combination of three things. Combination of meritocracy, okay, and also intra-party democracy, okay, it's like democracy within the party. Then, unfortunately, a bit of politics as well, okay. And so this is like let's just call it the Asian model of governance. But the good thing about this is that I mean it forces people to you know take a very long-term view because you know people get you know in China for example people get tested at the municipal level, then they get tested at the provincial level, and you know like you know this could be like 10 years you know at the city level another 10 years, province level another 10 years. Then you know, they finally make it to the central committee another 10 years. Then they can finally make it to the standing committee of the Politburo if you're lucky. Then for these people, you know, you can just look down at the party hierarchy and you see that who's going to be coming in 20 years, who's going to be the leader in 30 years. I mean, that's the kind of long-term view they can take. Because you know there's no like fundraiser to worry about. There's no like I mean you know, there's no all this electioneering. You know which brings which consumes like so much of politicians' time here, right? And you know which probably explains the short-term outlook you know that you just mentioned.
Hi, Joe Kong with KIC. You spoke about Korea and some of the unique economic characteristics that it has. Can you talk about maybe a couple other Asian countries that have unique structural characteristics that would either help them succeed or maybe struggle?
Okay. okay, the markets that I'm most familiar with are naturally Korea and Japan. So since I already talked about Korea, maybe talk about Japan a little bit. Although, you know, the share price in general has gone up, you know, since Prime Minister Abe, he also did the quantitative easing, right? And fought the deflation. That you still find many, many undervalued companies in Japan, meaning that you are talking about price-book ratio of like 0.5 or 0.6, okay? And these are listed companies, like, plain in your view, that the reason people don't invest in those companies is because the companies usually don't know how to unlock that value. The kind of value that we bring, people like us bring, is that we actually go into a foreign country, which you know these you know small cap companies would never dream of you know going on their own, right? We go in there and then you know like identify a good partner for them, we actually bring them together so that you know it's going to be like a mutually beneficial relationship to the local economy, also to the Japanese company, what I'm trying to say is. What I'm trying to say about the unique characteristic of Japan is that if you know where to look, there's so many opportunities. But if you are a purely passive investor, okay, let's just say you look at, oh, this company has PBR of 0.5, so sooner or later it has to rise, okay? So you invest, you wait 1 year, you wait 2 years, you wait 3 years, nothing happens, right? Or, you know, you can try becoming an activist, like that, you know, steal partners or whoever, and you tell the management to change, and usually the Japanese would just, you know, kind of like, become very insular, you know, and defensive, and you know, like they were like, oh, we don't need foreigners to tell us what to do, right? And so I think our approach is still the best, which is we become a strategic minority investor and take a friendly approach to the management, and then we work with them to unlock that value, which maybe in the mature market of Japan is not so useful, but if they bring it to, like, say, Vietnam, it could be very useful. So I'll give you an example. Recently, we actually brought a edible oil company from Japan to Vietnam to work with the largest privately owned edible oil company there. And so they have like this nationwide distribution, but you know, they are just doing edible oil. Whereas the Japanese company, you know, they can teach them how to do like the margarines and butter and you know, like the more like value added stuff. You know, go down further in the value chain. So, just to summarize, it's that for investors to profit from Japan, that you need to be actively involved, but not in an activist way.
Kind of wanted to follow up on that. I remember several years ago when I went to Korea to look at this small cap company. It was involved in technology, but somehow it also owned a soju business. And so one of the questions I asked was, why own this soju business? Mentioned that because my family member needed some help with funding, so I invested in that business. And it was actually pretty difficult to convince the management why they should divest those assets and so on. So what are some of the things that you can say to those management to help them understand that this is probably not the best
way? These owner founders actually sell off their business. I would say like 3 D's. Okay, death, divorce, and the debt. Okay, unless there's a compelling reason, you know, these people usually don't want to sell the control of their business. They want to maintain control, but they are usually quite open to having a strategic minority investor who can, especially if they can bring a strategic value to them. That's why, you know, unlike the buyout funds in the US, we do not insist on taking management control. We always want to go in them as kind of friendly minority, but with enough safeguards and rights so that you know, at least we have some say in the management. And also in the worst case scenario, we can actually force them to buy our stake or, you know, like whatever. I mean, so with enough protection for our investors as well.
Okay. Was there a question over here?
My name is Remco. So are you against general elections for Asian societies?
Oh, I wouldn't say it. I wouldn't go that far. What I'm saying is, the best thing about democracy is that, you know, it's going to prevent the worst abuse of power, right? That it makes sure that, you know, if you have a, you know, clearly incompetent leader, then you know, the voters can, you know, kick them out, you know, every 4 years or every 5 years. All I'm saying is that, you know, I'm not saying the institution does not matter, but what I'm saying is that we need to perhaps shift our focus from democratic institution building to the moral quality of leadership, and especially with the,
But without legal constrictions.
You need some institution. You need a combination of both. You need some institutional reform. Okay, but institutional reform alone will not accomplish what you're trying to accomplish if the leaders are, you know, like incompetent or corrupt or both, right? I mean, so I think what the recent government shutdown shows is that, you know, I mean, the U.S. government shutdown shows is that even the best institution in the world cannot function if elected leaders relentlessly pursue their self-interest, or if a major political party acts as if its only goal is to win the next election and triggers a fiscal crisis towards that end. And all I'm saying is you know, that institutional reform has limits. You also need the education and the culture that has to go along with that. So take Africa, for example. I mean, what's the problem with this sub-Saharan sub-Sahara African countries, you bring democracy to them, then, you know, who gets elected is like this corrupt general, right? And then, you know, is there any solution to this problem? It's just long-term education of leaders, right?
Well, there's many other problems in Africa right, that you cannot summarize in a sentence. But I doubt that Confucian morality can solve the problems that democracy faces in the West.
The book is not about, you know, what to do with the U.S., okay? It's about how Confucianism holds the key to solving China's challenges in the 21st century, assuming the Chinese Communist Party will not voluntarily adopt elective democracy. That's just out of question. Then what's the alternative? That's sort of like where this book is coming from. Again, I'm not denying the importance of institution. If you just compare North Korea and South Korea, okay, two countries with very similar cultures and very similar history and geography, then you see why there's such divergence in the outcome is because of the institution, right?
Okay, maybe a couple more questions.
How much time do you give a company you invest in, how much time do you give them to meet your financial objectives? And in the case of private companies, do you have a well-defined exit strategy before you go in?
I think we must have a well-defined exit strategy before making any investment. Preferably, we would like to have several options. Meaning usually several strategic buyer candidates corporate option, basically an option for us to sell back to the promoter the stakes that we own. Now, how much time do we give to our portfolio companies to make those changes? Pretty short. And what I mean by that is usually the companies we go in and restructure, they usually achieve a turnaround within the first year. Because usually it's very well defined before we make the investment what to do. So after the investment, it's just a matter of implementing. Are they going to sell off unprofitable business line? Are they going to do something about that non-performing portfolio of asset on their books? How they're going to strengthen their core business? Is it going to be some kind of strategic alliance with a partner? These things have to be all defined before we actually make the investment. So after the investment, usually within 1 year.
Okay, last question. Okay, maybe I'll ask the last question then. If Confucius were alive today, what would be his recommendation for China and also for the U.S.?
What would be his recommendation for China and the U.S. if Confucius were alive today? Okay, I think for China, I think his recommendation would be that creating a virtuous society starts from the top. And I'll give you an example. There was this exchange in the Analects where he's facing his lord, okay, the Lord Qi, okay, and the Confucius. And the Lord Qi basically asked Confucius, there are so many thieves in our state. What am I going to do about them? And the Confucius replied, if your highness were not greedy, people would not steal, even if you rewarded them for doing so. Wow, talk about courage, huh? So he's telling Lord Qi straight to his face, there are so many thieves in our country because you, sir, are greedy. Okay? And imagine a modern-day professor of Beijing University going to the standing committee of the Politburo and telling them, if you gentlemen really cleaned up your acts, which senior official would dare not follow? If the senior officials cleaned up their acts, which junior official would dare not follow? Eradicating corruption is not difficult. If the leaders practiced what they preach, the rank and file would naturally fall in line. Okay, so that would be the advice for China. And then as far as the U.S. is concerned, maybe I would quote from Mencius, who's a follower of Confucius. Okay. When Mencius went to see King Hui of Liang, about 2,300 years ago, and then the king welcomes him, sir, since you have come a distance of 1,000 leagues, what advice can you offer to profit my kingdom? And then Mencius immediately replies him back, saying that, why does His Majesty talk about profit? What I can offer are counsels for benevolence and righteousness, and they are my only topics. And the lesson I'm trying to convey here is that as society, which prizes profit-making above all else, is bound to decay sooner or later. And that would be the Confucian message for the materialistic value, which seems to unfortunately pervade our society today, not just in the U.S., but you know, whether you go to Dubai or London or wherever, right?
Jung-kyu, thank you for your time today. Thank you, audience, for being here today.